Hello there. Today we're going to be taking an in-depth look at the C3 respirator and some of the drills that you would be required to know in the Dutch Army in order to use this respirator. We have previously covered this respirator before in a previous video, which you can see here. And of course, as always, we will be referencing our handy Handbook for the Soldat. This is the 1985 version, which has all the drills in. Don't forget, if you like the video, don't forget to like and subscribe and share this video to get more traction on it. Since making that video, we have had some feedback from some people that served in the Dutch military during the 1980s, and particularly former Captain Roland van der Akker. With the rear here, you lift up both of these two straps, like so, and then you place the belt roughly where you get the cross part here. So, and then the respirator bag is then able to be worn on the body. Who said to us that the respirator, the Velcro, should be going through the D-loops. Now, we wanted to just include that in this video so that there is no confusion around how you're supposed to actually put the respirator bag on. So thank you very much to Roland for just pointing that out to us at our Military Odyssey show 2023. So first of all, we're just going to go over what the bag actually looks like. So there are a number of different versions of this bag, which you get more of like a canvas one. There's a rubberized canvas like this one, and then there's a much later kind of plasticized one like you see with some of the later webbing systems. Now, of course, you have your cross strap, which goes over your shoulder, and the waist strap, which goes around your waist. Now, this respirator bag is set up in what would be referred to as the peacetime setup. So it's not got everything in that you'd be expected to carry in a wartime scenario. So in the front pouch here, you have your mongkap, which is a sort of dust mask, which we will also cover because that is featured in the 1985 handbook. You also have your decontamination tube, which contains what the British Army referred to as Fuller's Earth. It's basically used for absorbing chemical agents. Additionally, in here, you also have your IK3-20, which is an instruction card, which just gives you a brief overview of what you are supposed to be doing in certain scenarios. And on the front page gives you a reminder of the coloured triangles that are used by all of NATO when looking at contaminated areas. In the small side pocket here, you also have your filter cap as well, like so. In the wartime, you would also have your detector papers, and you would also have your atropine pens and your auto injectors in there as well. In the main compartment, of course, is your C3 respirator, like so. This features a front diaphragm, your respirator, or your filter, sorry, and your two eyepieces, and then on the rear, you then have your elasticated straps to go over your head. Now, the C3 was adopted to replace the Model K gas mask, and it was adopted in the 1980s. This is a Canadian design, so the bag and the respirator are both of Canadian origin. This one here has actually been made by the Baron Rubber Company, as you can see here. It's a medium, and this particular one was produced in 1988. You will sometimes find the filters will have a red sort of band around the filter here, and that is to denote that it is a training version. The filter is held on with a 60mm screw thread, like so, and this is a pretty standard size filter for the time and for the origin, which is of course a NATO country. So with the C3, first of all, you need to make sure that you have the respirator adjusted correctly. Now, this is done through a very particular drill, which is explained in the handbook. So you must first take off the filter, take off your headdress, and in my case, take off the glasses. You would then pull the straps back, place your chin in, pull the straps over your head, and place your hand over the inlet side, and then you breathe in very hard. This is to ensure that the rubber is forming a airtight seal around your face. Now, obviously the Dutch Army is known for its relaxed rules on facial hair, and in times of war and on exercise, you would be expected to shave this off. With the exception of having a well-trimmed mustache, you were allowed to keep hold of that. So this is putting and adjusting the respirator on. So this respirator is correctly adjusted to my head. As you can see there, when I breathed in and when I breathed out, it formed a airtight seal around the edge here. So when you're actually putting on the mask, what you would do is you would close your eyes and remove your helmet. You would hold your breath and remove the NBC cap off of the respirator filter. However, a lot of soldiers would obviously carry it with the respirator filter on. What you would do is you would remove the respirator from the bag. You would grab the straps at the rear, and in the same way as you put on it for adjusting, you would put your chin in first, pull the straps over the head. You would then adjust it by grabbing the outlet valve, and you would breathe out and shout, gas, gas, gas.
Gas, gas, gas.
So a couple of the ways that you'd be able to tell if you were currently undergoing a gas or chemical attack is by having the detector papers. Now the detector papers would be attached to your NBC suit, or you would have detector papers on vehicles. And depending on what color the detector papers went, this would indicate the kind of attack that you were having. So if you got a blue or green discoloration, that would be persistent nerve agents, so things like sarin. Yellow and orange would be non-persistent nerve agents, and red would be a vesicant such as mustard gas. Now, the other way that you would be able to tell or be notified of a attack is through either the shouting of gas, 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 spray, 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 fallout, fallout, fallout. You would also have people with whistles and bells, and you would also have alarms that would go off. So in 1 second bursts, every other second would indicate that there is a gas attack. Interestingly, also used in the West German army, which the Dutch had to practice alongside, you would see a yellow, red, and then a yellow flare, which would also whistle. And this would indicate an attack from some kind of nerve agent or from some kind of chemical agent. Now, the standard drill in doing all of this would be to, you would lay down on the floor, you would close your eyes, and you would cover your hands. The thinking behind this is that if you're far enough away from a chemical agent or a nuclear attack, you would be able to cover all of the most vital parts of your body, and the fallout or nerve agent would fall onto your back. Now, interestingly, with the C3, the respirator will not protect you against carbon monoxide. It will only protect you against chemical agents, which is why during firefighting drills, things like the Corps Mobile wouldn't be using the C3. They'd be using civilian respirators for firefighting duties. And also the... what was my other point there? So... how would you know if you were under some kind of chemical agent attack? Now, there are these things called detector papers, which would be put onto your NBC suit, or you would occasionally have them installed in other places in the camp. Now, depending on what color discoloration you would get with these, that would depend on the kind of nerve agent that you were getting hit with or other kind of chemical agent. So if you get a blue or green discoloration, this means that it is a persistent nerve agent or persistent chemical attack, such as sarin. If it goes yellow or orange discoloration, this is a volatile nerve agent, And if it goes red, then this is a vesicant, something like mustard gas. The other way is that you would have gas bells and you would have whistles, which would be blown in three short bursts. You would also have people shouting, gas, 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 shpoi, 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 fallout, 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 to indicate what kind of attack you were coming under. You also get 1 second bursts every other second to indicate when you are having a chemical attack. Now, interestingly, the West German army, the Bundeswehr, would also use whistling flares in the sequence yellow, red, yellow. The Dutch army didn't use this, but because of the fact that they would so closely train together, they would have to be aware of this fact as well. And you would also get, in the German Democratic Republic, you would get 1 minute sirens followed by two times interruption. And in the Netherlands, you would have three times 30 second howls of some kind of alarm. So as part of your later NBC equipment, you would also be issued one of these, which is referred to as a duckbill or a dust mask. So this is not designed to protect you against chemical agents. It's designed to protect you against fallout, where you don't need to place your respirator on, because the filters in your respirator will only last for around an hour to an hour and a half in a compromised environment. So these are designed to protect you against dust. So in the same way with the NBC, with the respirator, you would place this onto your face like so, by putting your chin in first, pulling the strap over the top of your head, and then you would adjust using these straps here and also closing it around your nose and your mouth like so. Now, the remainder of your NBC gear, in terms of the parka and the trousers, you would be issued in a bag like so, which is a large sort of plastic bag that you would tear open, and then inside are the vacuum packed trousers and jacket. You would then also obviously get issued your boots, your gloves and your inner gloves. Now, once you'd been issued this, you would then be expected to pack it away into one of these, which is essentially a large sort of waterproof plastic bag with a carrying strap. The idea of this is that you would keep it underneath the seat of your armoured vehicle, and then it is readily available for you to grab and pull out. So in here you have your Velcro placing. So you have your boots. These are a later model, which don't have the drawstrings to close them. You then have your jacket, like so. Now, often soldiers would write their personal information on the front here. This belonged to someone who was in the Marines, so they've written their name, their service number, their unit, their blood type and their rank on the front there. This is the same as the British design of NBC jacket. So you are able to see more about this on our Facebook page, as we have a specific post about the NBC shirt. As you can see, I used this at an event last, so it has bits of lichen and bits of leaf included in it. And then you have your trousers in here as well, which the individual has also written their name and their name on the pocket as well here. These trousers belong to a different person, hence why they have a different name. And then in the front pocket here, you also then have your outer gloves, and then you would have your inner gloves. Don't forget, if you like the video, to like and subscribe, and make sure to follow us on our Facebook page to find out more information. And if you're interested in joining the group, feel free to email us at dosreenactment@gmail.com.